Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Bonsoir, mesdames et messieurs. Je m'appelle Anne Vroom et je suis la présidente des Amis de la Bibliothèque ici à McGill. It is my great pleasure to welcome you here this evening for this, and where we are very, very proud to be hosting the Blue Metropolis's first People's Prize event in the context of our 2016 Hugh MacLennan Memorial Lecture. This annual lecture series was founded in 1992 by the Friends of the Library in honor of the great Canadian Governor General Award-winning novelist and English professor Hugh MacLennan. Tonight, we are particularly honored to be partnering with the Blue Metropolis Literary Festival and to have as our guest speaker another Governor General Award-winning author and noted First Peoples advocate Thomas King, who will be interviewed by radio host Rosanna Deerchild. The Friends of the Library are a volunteer group of advocates who work to nurture community interest in the library at McGill. We host lectures and events throughout the year, and we also provide financial support for critical acquisitions and events. We are proud to have contributed recently to the feasibility study conducted here at McGill called Fiat Lux, which is reimagining the library for McGill within the current technological revolution that is taking place throughout North America, and will transform the facilities here at McGill to meet the evolving needs of the 21st century student. We would like to acknowledge for this evening the sponsorship of our MacLennan Lecture by Donald Walcott, and of the Blue Met Literary Prize of the J.W. McConnell Family Foundation and the Chadha Family Foundation. Your generous support of these literary events is essential to the life of the arts. I would now like to welcome to the podium Cameron Charlevoix, who is chairman of the board of the Blue Metropolis Foundation.
Thank you, Anne. I'll be very brief. Thank you all for being here. It's my pleasure to welcome you here on behalf of the Blue Metropolis Foundation to our festival. The festival is quite a grand success this year, and this is one of the most spectacular events we have, I think, as you'll find out in a moment. We have 233 events, where's Greg? 235 authors, 5 different languages happening in different venues without mediation between these different languages. It's a spectacular model of festival, and it really does bring people together. So to begin with this evening's activities, let's first acknowledge that this place, in McGill University, on Mount Royal, indeed all of Montreal, is located on the traditional territory of the Ganyangahaka people. And I've been told that if I butcher that word, use the word Mohawk. Whatever it is, this place, this island in the river, has been a place for meeting and human exchange, as we hope to achieve through the Blue Metropolis Festival as well, for First Peoples over many millennia. It's really important to underline and to underscore the fact that we are preceded in this place by First Peoples. On the screen, you saw the sponsors. Thank you, Anne, for mentioning those sponsors. And the Chadha Foundation and McConnell have been great supporters of Blue Metropolis, and we're really, really happy about that. And then, as we begin to begin the evening, this event with an important reading by Pen Canada in recognition of one of the many writers who are currently imprisoned around the world for simply expressing thought and ideas. So please welcome our very special collaborator from Pen Canada, Mark Abley.
Thank you, Cameron. Good evening. Bonjour. Sego. It's a privilege to be here today on behalf of Pen Canada, a human rights organization that campaigns for free expression and stands up for imprisoned authors around the world. At literary festivals, Pen Canada asks people to remember a writer who cannot be with us, someone unable to do what we are about to, exercise our right, even our obligation, to express ourselves freely. Raif Badawi is what you might call an inconvenient blogger. He is Saudi Arabian, and he was a founder of the Free Saudi Liberals website. Here's the truth about his story. In 2012, he was arrested and charged with the crimes of founding a liberal website, adopting liberal thought, and insulting Islam. He was sentenced to 10 years in prison, 1,000 lashes, a large fine, and a 10-year ban on participating in any media upon his eventual release. After the first 50 lashes had been inflicted, subsequent floggings were postponed because of his poor health. To this day, he remains incarcerated in a Saudi prison. He has no access to green grass or running water. The following is a very short excerpt from Raif Badawi's book, 1,000 Lashes, because I say what I think. The concept of a nation is wide. It includes everyone under its love. The wider it gets, the more hatred fills the hearts of some of our fellow citizens, adding layers of sectarianism, tribalism, and narrow ways of thinking. One of the most honorable bases for a united nation is that it should not be built on the specifics of one person, or one line of thought, or one organization, or one group that excludes everyone else. 1,000 Lashes was published in 2015 by Greystone Books. I'm told that copies of the French edition and perhaps the English edition too are still available at the Blue Metropolis bookstore in Hotel 10. If you'd like to learn more, take action, or support the work of Pen Canada on behalf of Raif Badawi, visit the website, www.pencanada.ca. I'll be outside the door after this event with a petition on Raif Badawi's behalf asking for his immediate and unconditional release. I hope many of you will sign. Thank you. Merci. Niawe.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Gregory McCormick, and I am the Director of Programming here at Blue Metropolis. Thank you all so much for being here tonight on this very special occasion. I just want to start by saying a few thank yous. First of all, thank you so much to the Friends of McGill Library. It's a new partner for us, though honestly, we've been talking about partnering for a number of years. When you start a new partnership every year, there's a few little snafus. Some of the snafus were our fault. So I just wanted to say thank you so much to the Friends of McGill Library for being so professional and so generous and for sharing this space with us and for being a part of this event tonight to honor Thomas King. Tonight, I also want to just send a quick thank you to the Chada Foundation. I don't think Balji's here, but Roshi, I know, is traveling. So thank you so much for your support, and a very special thank you to the McConnell Foundation. The McConnell Foundation has been a big supporter of Blue Met, as Cameron mentioned before, and they are champions of this prize. They are champions of First Nations writing. They are champions of working with First Nations communities for all kinds of important reasons. And I think I just want to sort of acknowledge Lawrence Miao, who's here tonight from the Chada Foundation, and to say thank you for your support. Tonight, I'm going to ask Jason Lewis to present the prize. And I just want to say a couple things. Jason Lewis is a member of the committee which awards this prize. And he has been a big, important supporter and source of counsel and advice on this prize since the very beginning. And I work with Concordia and McGill in many different projects, and his name is always coming up. Everybody seems to know him, and everyone seems to rave about him. So we're so honored that he's here tonight to present the prize. So I'll just give his official biography. Jason Lewis is a digital media poet, artist, and software designer. He's a university research chair in computational media and the Indigenous Future Imaginary, as well as a professor of computation arts at Concordia. He co-directs the Initiative for Indigenous Futures, the Aboriginal Territories in Cyberspace Research Network, and the Skins Workshop on Aboriginal Storytelling. And I just love that name, the Skins Workshop. It's great. He is born and raised in Northern California, and he is Cherokee, Hawaiian, and Samoan. So let's welcome Jason here. And now we are very proud to announce and to call to the stage the 2016 Blue Metropolis First Peoples Literary Prize winner, Mr. Thomas King.
Photo op. So we're in Mohawk territory, huh? I say that because the Mohawk and the Cherokee share a common cultural background. We're both Iroquoian. The Mohawks say Sego, the Cherokee say Osio. So it's close enough. We can't understand each other, but that's never been a problem. We moved away a long time ago, so there. It's wonderful to be in Montreal. I've only been here, I think, one other time, believe it or not. I'd like to say I didn't come for the food, but that would be probably a lie. I actually came to see the most famous road in Montreal that I've been told about for a number of years, a road called Rue Barrée. And I found it. It wasn't that hard, to be honest with you. I'd like to thank the Friends of McGill Library, the J.W. McConnell Family Foundation, the Chautauqua Family Foundation, the Blue Metropolis First Peoples Literary Prize Committee, and Aboriginal storytellers everywhere from whom I take my strength and steal stories from time to time. I never know what to do with acceptance speeches. I'm really good at being very funny. I'm not very good at being serious. So, you know, thank all of you for being here tonight, and thank those individuals for making this possible. Have I missed anybody, hon? Okay. What's that? Oh, Donald Walker. Sorry. See, it's no longer there. I'm sorry. Where are you? I thanked him earlier on, didn't I? Tell them I did. All right. Tonight, rather than give a lecture, which you would not enjoy and I would enjoy even less, I've gotten to an age where I've gotten tired of hearing the sound of my own voice. My good buddy out of the West, Rosanna Deerchild, and I are going to do a dog and moose show, eh? we've interviewed each other years past, so, and she's really excellent and a fine poet. They've got some of your books out there, don't they? And are you up for some awards, or have those been announced yet, or anything?
More nominations. I'm not yet a Thomas King.
Uh-huh. But you're coming up on my
tail. I'm coming up on you, bro.
All right, well, let's get to the interview then, and have some fun and see if we can enjoy ourselves tonight. Thank you very much.
You want me to take that for you? Okay. Perfect. Thank you. Thank you. I just wanted to officially announce and introduce Rosanna Deerchild. Rosanna Deerchild came all the way to Montreal just for this event, and we are so thrilled that she could and that she was willing to come. I don't know if, I think many of you do know, but if you do not know her show Unreserved, which is broadcast out of CBC Winnipeg, it should be at the top of your playlist, and I cannot emphasize this enough. It is such a fantastic show. Not, you know, when you just read the news, you hear the sad stories. You don't hear the funny stories. You don't hear the moving stories. You don't hear the stories of everyday life of First Peoples in Canada, all over Canada. And I think what she brings to her show and what she brings to the CBC and what she brings to our country is a real true picture of what life is like for First Nations people. And again, listen to her show, put it on your playlist because it's fantastic. And so many people have come up to me in the last few weeks and said, I love that show. I'm so happy she's here. So anyway, enough of my gushing. I just want to say thank you so much. Rosanna. She's the host of Unreserved on CBC Radio 1. She's an award-winning Cree author and has been a broadcaster for almost 20 years, which is hard to believe because you don't look like you've been... she's done stints with APT and CBC Radio Global and a variety of Indigenous newspapers, and she hails from Opipan Na Piwan Cree Nation. Let's all welcome Rosanna Deerchild.
Let's have fun.
Always. All right. Thank you so much. That was so nice, making me blush. I could blush more, but you know, it's all about Thomas. Thank you so much to the Blue Met for inviting me. It is my pleasure and always my privilege to speak to Dr. King. Rather than tell you all what you already know, you know, he is an award-winning author, he is a storyteller, he is a photographer, he's an artist, he is a thinker, a philosopher, a rabble-rouser, and really old.
Really old. You know, the only thing she said true was that.
7 decades with something there.
Oh, let's not go there.
Rather than that, I'm going to just tell you a little short story about me and Thomas. Me and Thomas. It's always a good way to start a story. As you know, I'm a bit of a fan. I've read many of his books, most of his books. And I've been to a few events of his where I've stood in line like many other fans to get his autograph. Now, the first time that he signed a book for me, he wrote, "To Rosanna, best Thomas King." It's like, oh, that's nice. That's lovely. And then the second book he signed for me was The Inconvenient Indian, where he wrote, "To Rosanna, good to see you again, Thomas King." Like, well, that's nice. It's good to see me, too. The third time, we'd had some interactions since then, and a couple interviews in there. We've gotten to know each other, just a scotch. And I stood in line for 20 minutes to get his interview, very long, and I also got your lovely wife, Helen's, interview on her. And he wrote, now what I asked him to write was, "For Rosanna, my dearest friend and best fan of all time." What he wrote was, "For Rosanna, oh, go to hell." Zoom in. Zoom in.
There are a few people that have that.
Best autograph ever. So let's get to the, I have like 50 million questions. We do have a short Q&A, so if I miss anything, you all will be sure to, you know, ask the questions that I missed. My first question involves stories and this idea of stories, of course, which you've written extensively about in The Truth About Stories. You say that is all we are.
Yeah.
And in speaking to many authors and storytellers and writers and artists that tell story or that are story, they often say the story found them.
Hmm.
Where did story find you?
Oh, I think I sort of chase them down. I stay hidden, so they have a hard time finding me. But I like to listen. I like to go places and just keep my ears open and see what I hear. You know, people talk to me sometimes. Sometimes they shouldn't. It's just listening for the stories to come along. And, you know, I've got a house by the river. If they want to come and visit me, they can. I've got a little espresso machine. If they like some espresso, they can have some of that while they're talking to me. And people tell me stories when I'm on the road. Sometimes they come up and want, you know, a 25% cut of the story if I use it in a novel. I tell them that's not possible. And sometimes they have stories that are beyond what fiction can handle, that are just too bizarre that nobody would believe them in a novel. And sometimes they're interesting. I'm always looking for the small story. Mm. Those are the stories that interest me the most. Not the big ones, not the brutal ones, not the ones with a lot of action in them particularly, but just something that catches my imagination, just a little splinter sometimes. And those are the stories that I wait to show up.
Do you remember which story splinter, the first story splinter that caught you?
The first book that I wrote, Medicine River, way back when? Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably. It was a plain native basketball. Well, actually, what it was, to be honest with you. I was trying to make time with this really good-looking woman out in Lethbridge. And she liked writers, but she didn't much like Americans. And I had just come from the States in 1980. And so I was trying to impress her as best I could. And she wasn't too impressed with my cooking at that point. I've become a better cook since then. But I knew she liked stories. And so I thought, well, I'll write a story to impress her. So I was playing native basketball with these guys off the reserve, and I started writing stories about, you know, my experience there. And that really started the whole thing. It was my way of getting to first base, as we used to say in the old days, before that kind of language is, you know, frowned upon at this point. So.
And did you snag, or what happened? Oh.
No, not snag.
That's the language.
A long-term relationship developed out of the writing and our mutual admiration for each other's brains.
And I'm so sure there was lots of brain sharing.
There was a lot of brain sharing. Yeah. Not as much now, perhaps, as there was before, but.
So is that the moment you thought, this writing thing, this is friggin' genius?
It's like having a convertible.
I'm not going to ask what you mean by that. Now, you've written in many, and you've spoken about this many times, about being raised by a single mother.
Yep.
And how the absence of your father had a profound effect on you, Thomas King, the person. How did it inform or inspire Thomas King, the writer?
Well, I don't know. I suppose not many writers are able to answer that question. We make up answers. When people would ask me about my father, I used to make up stories about him, because I didn't have any stories about him, but I needed to have some, so I made them up. Mm-hmm. And that worked out pretty well for the time being. What was your question?
Inspired.
See what happens after the seventh decade?
That's right. It's a good thing.
Inspired.
Informed.
Yeah. My mother wasn't a storyteller particularly. She was much too busy to fool around with stories. My grandmother was a bit of a storyteller. There were storytellers, you know, around the neighborhood and whatnot. I think what inspired me was because I didn't have a father, and because I didn't have a kind of grounding, to be honest with you. My mother did the best she could, but I think I was a hard kid to raise. My brother was easier than I was. I've lost my train of thought again. I'm going to have to get some coffee in me. I think what happened was watching my mother try to work her way through that male-oriented world gave me a different perspective on the world than I would have had if my father had been there, if I had been raised in a man's world. And I watched my mother put up with all sorts of shit from the guys at work and all sorts of stuff from the society at large, because she was not only a single mother, but she was a divorcee. And in those days, the thing you wanted to do as quickly as possible was to remarry, so you had that anchor, mm-hmm. as it were. And sometimes it was an anchor that just dragged you under. Saw that enough times. And so I had a fine understanding of my mother's tentative situation within that society, and it really pissed me off.
Yeah.
Really pissed me off quite a bit. And so when I write about women in my books, I try to make sure that I do an adequate job, as good a job as I can with those characters, not simply dismiss them as appendages for the male characters in the piece. Matter of fact, the new book I'm working on, if it ever gets done, I sort of ran into a wall, and I haven't made it past the wall, has quite a number of female characters. And I didn't realize it until I was about 120 pages in. I said, wait a minute, are there any guys in this thing? And realized that there was one guy in it at that point. So I think all that's, you know, what happened to me as a kid, watching my mother, remembering those years, even talking to her. Now she's 94, and still kicking. You know, every time she, my brother and I went out to visit her this year, and she says to me, she says, now, Tom, she says, take care of your little brother. I mean, Christopher is 70 years old. And she says to Christopher, she says, now, don't give your older brother a hard time. We walked out the door, and we said, what are we, 13 again? And the answer for her was, yeah, we are. We are. Nothing much has changed.
For sure. I still live with my mother, and she made sure I packed clean underwear.
Yeah. This is why we leave home.
But then they find you again, and they come and live with you. It's.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I've been lucky.
I can't tell you how lucky I feel.
Oh, yeah. I can see how happy you are, eh?
Now, in terms of identity, how does that factor into you as a storyteller? Is it storyteller, indigenous person? Are they one and the same? How does that?
Yeah, again, it's one of those tough questions to answer. I mean, I was raised in a small valley town in Central California. My father was not there. My mother's family was Greek. And so I was pretty much raised by that side of the family. But I was, as I was growing up, if you would see photographs of me in those days, you could see that I didn't look like the rest of the kids. Mm. Matter of fact, it's taken me a long time to come to grips with the very pale complexion of my skin. Things that you sort of bleach out. You don't die off, but you sort of bleach out. Because I used to be really, really dark. My brother and I were both really dark. We've got photographs of ourselves with the rest of the kids, and you know, there was some real concern about those photographs. And so, I mean, I knew I wasn't a member of that larger community in the town that I was raised in. There were no blacks in town. There were a number of Mexican families that had come up to work the fields. They were called braceros, the arms. And at one point in time, actually, the senior prom came along, and I thought, well, I'll take a chance and ask this one young woman out. And the reason I was going to ask her, I liked her, but she also, I knew, had a heart defect, not a major one, but a heart defect. And I thought, well, okay, you know, an Indian guy taking out a white girl, but she has a heart defect. And so, yeah, this... and so I asked her out, and she said, yeah. And I thought, wow, all right, great, that's wonderful. And then I guess about 2 weeks or a week before the prom, she called me up and said she couldn't go with me. She danced with me at the prom, but she couldn't go out on a date because her father didn't want her dating Mexicans. And like a fool, I said, well, good news, I'm not Mexican, I'm Native. As if that was going to make any difference at all for him. So those kinds of things, they don't form an identity, but they sort of push you in that way. And I was curious about my father. And then in the when I was out of high school, I graduated in 61, I guess, and 64 to 67, I was in Australia and New Zealand working as a photojournalist. And when I came back, the civil rights movement had morphed into the ethnic movement, and I became part of that. And got involved in that. And that sort of set me on the path that I have today. So I was a frontline activist for a while, you know, shaking my fist, going on radio and television, making these speeches that I'm certainly glad there is nothing left of at this point on videotape. And that's where actually I discovered a great secret about storytelling, and that is that you can tell the truth, and you can tell it straight out, and you can tell it with feeling and with conviction, and you can be right, and it doesn't mean anybody's going to listen to you. You have to figure out some way to present that information in a form that they will take in, that they will actually let it get past their defenses, And so humor for me, satire in particular, became the way to do that so that I could get past that first line of defenses, be in there before they knew I was there when it was too late. When they were sort of laughing and kind of, you know, maybe a little bleeding at the same time. So that taught me a great lesson about how to write a story, how to craft a story, especially if the story is about something serious.
You talk about, and you write about this moment where you were that angry Indian, quote unquote, with the buckskin and the beads and the,
oh, I look
and
good.
And the braids. I would like some pictures, first of all, photography. Mm-hmm. Photographic evidence of that. But
I've got some.
Excellent. Can we just put them up on the screen?
No. Those are in the vault. When I try to grow my hair long, it gets down to about here, and then it starts getting curly. And by the time it gets to my shoulders, it looks like a really bad fright wig. And it ruins the entire picture. It's supposed to be long and straight, you know, hooked nose and whatnot. I did have a beaded belt buckle and a little leather pouch, and I had a four-strand bone choker, which I couldn't bring myself to wear all that often. But I had a headband when I was at university, and I looked good.
You look good.
I look good. I look mean. I look tough.
Now, in writing about that, you said that there was this moment, and I'm going to ask you to talk a little bit about that, where you were that angry Indian and you were fist shaking.
Yeah.
And it occurred to you that people weren't taking you as seriously as non-Indigenous people who were there on the same stage, at the same podium, talking about the same thing.
Yeah, that was one of the seminal moments for me in my nascent political career. Was we were at Chico State in Chico, California, and there was a Mohawk guy, actually, Richard Glazier Danay. He's an artist, lives down in Southern California. He and I had started the first Native organization at Chico State. It was a small thing. It was in the dirt basement of one of the buildings. It wasn't much to talk about, but, you know, we got along. And we were asked to be on a panel with two guys from the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And so we said, sure, you know, a chance to, you know, read them the Riot Act. And so we got up there, and it was Richard and myself and these two other guys, and then this moderator who would invite us, a nice woman who would invite us to be on stage with them. And so we did our bit. Richard was less vehement than I was, I think, as I remember, and I was pretty, you know, I'm really getting this going.
Plus, you looked good.
So. I looked good. And then the two guys from the Bureau of Indian Affairs, this is in the States, put up their pie charts and their, you know, column things to show how much better things had gotten for Native people in the last 50 years. And, you know, then everybody applauded and clapped. And we came off the stage, and as we came off the stage, the BIA guys were in front of us, and as they came off the stage, the woman who had invited us shook the hand with one and handed them an envelope with the other. So, you know, shake the hand, hand the envelope. And I knew what that envelope was. I mean, even as young as I was and not used to this sort of thing, I knew that was an honorarium check. And so when we came off the stage, took her hand, no envelope. And Richard shook her hand, no envelope. And so I thought, you know, I got to ask about this. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it was an invitation. Maybe it was coupons to McDonald's. Who knows? And so I pulled her off to one side, and I said, look, I said, you know, when the BIA guys came off the stage, you handed them an envelope. I said, what was in the envelope? You know, I'm just curious what was in the envelope. And she said, well, that was an honorarium. And I said, and where are Richard and my honorarium? And she, to her credit, she looked embarrassed and, you know, uncomfortable. And she said, after all, they're the experts. And I said to her, I said, so what are we, entertainment? And I realized at that point that's what we were. We were entertainment. You know, the angry Indian, the mad Indian, film at 11, come and see him. And I said to myself, you know, I'll be a lot of things, but I'll be damned if I'll be entertainment again. Mm. And that was really a moment that sort of, told me if I was going to have an impact, if I was going to change people's minds, if I was going to get information that was important out into that larger world, either through making speeches or possibly through writing, although at that point I didn't consider myself a writer at all. I didn't even imagine that. Mm-hmm. Then, I'm going to have to figure out some way to do that without simply being entertainment where people can clap for you and then walk away afterwards. That was a waste of my time and a waste of my energy. So
why then did you choose humor? What was it about humor that you found reached audiences where anger did not?
Nobody likes to be yelled at. Nobody likes to be told what they should do. Nobody likes to be told what they did wrong, even if it's all true. Mm. Even if it's all true. Especially if it's all true. It's sort of like lifting the covers and go, oh. So they don't like that. But if you can get them to sort of be on your side, and you can have a couple of chuckles and you can make them feel as though everything is okay, then you can talk to them about serious things. I mean, when you talk to your kids, sometimes, when Officer Friendly calls and you say, okay, who knows Officer Friendly? What's this about? A little bit of humor goes a long way in diffusing those kinds of situations. I mean, even in personal relationships, Helen and I every so often sort of go like that. Whenever that happens, I always try to figure out some way to make it humorous or to do something that'll make us laugh. Because if we laugh, then it breaks that tension. Mm-hmm. And that tension doesn't build and gets to something else. So in my writing, I always try to leave a spot for some humor to bring that down. Not to take away from the impact of what I'm trying to say, but to make it palatable. I suppose it's, my mother used to give us this god-awful tasting crap that we had to eat every winter. And I think if she'd put some sugar on it or, something, it might have been easier to manage, but mm-hmm. she didn't.
No,
she hadn't learned the lesson I learned.
Do you remember the first time you did use humor and you saw that it was reaching people in a way you hadn't before?
Yeah, I was on a television show in Salt Lake City and I was doing my angry Indian bit on the show, and I forget exactly what happened, but it was a joke about horses. That's all I remember. And the guy who was interviewing me started laughing. And when he started laughing, he was much friendlier to me. Beforehand, he had been, really standoffish. Like, Mr. King, you say that the U.S. government doesn't recognize Indian rights. Just what do you mean by that? And I would say, well, you stupid son of a bitch, If you knew anything about Native history, you wouldn't ask that dumb question. So instead of doing that, I made a joke about horses, I think. He was a horse guy, and I made a joke about horses. And he liked the joke, and he laughed. And I thought, and he was friendlier to me afterwards, and he caught me afterwards. And he says, I was kind of worried about that interview, but, that was okay. That was a good joke. I enjoyed that. So I thought, whoa. I mean, you got to be sort of brain dead not to see those opportunities when they come along and understand them. I mean, I've got nothing against people being really pissed off about what's happened. I mean, if I was living on a reserve in Canada right now, I would really be hot. Mm. About the kind of treatment. I mean, I lived through the Harper years when I had to go on shows and commentators would say, well, the Harper Conservatives have given, let's say, $10 million to Native people. And I would say, how much of that money actually gets to Native people? Do you know that? And they would say, oh, no, $10 million. I said, no, it's not $10 million. I said, for one thing, most of that money wasn't even given in the first place. It was just announced it was going to be given. Then some of it went to the bureaucracy and not to Native people themselves. the amount, the small amount that made it down to the grassroots level for clean water or good housing was minuscule, if there was anything at all. Mm-hmm. I said, anybody can say, I can say I'm going to give the government $10 million. Doesn't mean I'm going to, doesn't mean it happens. But and it just drove me nuts, because people within would say, well, you know, why is there such a problem on reserves when the government is pouring money into the reserves? And the answer is they're not pouring money anyplace. They may be pouring into their own pockets, they may be pouring into the pockets of consultants, they may be doing a great deal with it, but much of that money doesn't even get to the reserve. Mm-hmm. So it, that wasn't very friendly, was it? I can see people headed for the exits right now. My apologies. I'll do better next time.
How much of your humor do you feel is...
too much?
Well, it's never too much, honey. Is based in Indigenous identity. I mean, we're funny people.
Hysterical.
We're hilarious people. We have aunties and cousins, yep. And we just like laughing and making fun of each
teasing.
Other and teasing.
Yep.
So are we truly funny, or are we just really sarcastic assholes?
Well, Rosanna. I think part of it is simply a survival strategy. I think that things have been, in some places, for many of our people, so bad for so long that all you can do is joke about it and try to do the best you can. I think humor is a way of keeping ourselves from going absolutely crazy. Mm. I think we learned that. Most of the really great Native storytellers, oral storytellers, or people who are writing, have a good sense of humor. Mm-hmm. And it is so critical to hear that. There was an old guy named Harry Robinson out in the Okanagan, who wrote a couple of books of stories. And I heard he was I never heard him speak, but I heard he was a terrific storyteller. But the guy really knew his way around a story. There was a lot of humor in those stories, even if they were, depressing material. I mean, how can you possibly write a story about residential schools in this country, or mm-hmm. in the States for that matter, without just having it be just horrific? If you look at the information that's there, the facts of how those schools were run, the mortality rates at those schools, it is a horrible legacy. And you've got to talk about it. But if you're going to do that, you're going to have to, again, find some way. And for me, humor is, maybe it's not the answer, but at least it helps to leaven the situation. And this is the other interesting thing about humor. Humor deepens the tragedy. A little bit of humor will deepen the tragedy. You wouldn't think it would, but it does.
How so?
It's just because when you start thinking about, it adds an edge to it. It adds an edge to the tragedy. And a little bit of tragedy balances off the humor so that you don't have something that is completely silly and funny and misses the mark at all, or something that's so dense and so awful that it just crushes you. Mm. So in between there, some place is the magic spot to where you can laugh and say, my God, this is horrible. This is really bad. My idea in a book like, say, The Inconvenient Indian, when I was writing that, was I said, okay, what I have to do is make people laugh and cry at the same time. Mm-hmm. I have to find ways to do that to where I can present that material in a way that I get both of those reactions almost simultaneously. Somebody could argue that this is a cop-out, or I use humor to get away from keeping the tip of the spear sharp, and I couldn't disagree with that. Certainly, I suppose there is that danger that humor blunts that thrust. I think if it's well done, I don't think it does. Mm-hmm. But everybody has their own way of managing those stories.
You've managed to find that magic place, and it seems that you go to that magic place fairly easily in your work. You'll have the tragedy laced with the humor, and you cut and blow at the same time. It's an amazing gift that you have. Is that something that came naturally to you, or is that something that you work on constantly to achieve?
Oh, of course, it just came naturally to me. I didn't have to work on it at all. Thank you for asking.
Next question.
I really don't know. It's just me. I write in an oral style. Everything that I do in print, I make sure that I hear it. You know, I read it out loud so I can hear how the words sound. A lot of times when I'm working with students, writing students, they'll write a story and I'll say, okay, now what I want you to do is stand up at the podium and read that story. And they say, out loud? And I say, well, of course, out loud. And a lot of times they don't consider the oral quality of the story. They don't hear that voice. And it really is hysterical to watch what happens. They'll stand up at the podium, and I'll say, take your pencil with you. And they'll start reading, and you see them editing as they go, because they suddenly discover that the words don't sound the same as when they're just in their heads. When they're in their heads, they can skip across all sorts of errors, but when they're saying those words out loud, and they have to come up with a cadence and some kind of a reading style, suddenly those stories sound horrible, and they're scribbling as fast as they can to fix them. So I do that with all of my stories. I read them out loud so I know how they sound as an oral piece, even though it's written, even though I know that nobody else is going to read it out loud for the most part. Nonetheless, I'll do that so I can hear the cadence and the music of, of the language.
As a poet myself, I do the same thing. I read my work out loud. But another reason I do that is that I feel that a poem or a story or a piece of writing is not alive until you literally blow breath into it and give it life, and thus it becomes its own life and goes out into the world.
Well, I think that's perfectly true with poems, and besides, they're so short, you can take the time to read them. I'm talking about a whole novel, woman!
Thank you so much for your artistic support. Appreciate that.
No, actually, I have to say, of all the writing I do, poetry is the most difficult. Most difficult. You are working with a narrow little box, and you have to make sure everything works. With a novel, I can screw up a couple of chapters. Nobody cares. They skip right across them. But poetry, no, there's no room. There's no fat on a good poem.
Then Helen comes along, fixes it up for you.
Oh, geez, Helen, oh boy. She'll say to me things like, this was all right, but it's kind of pedestrian. Where she'll say, yeah, this is, but where are the women characters? I said, I've got four. Be nice if you had five. And, you know, have you read this, Tom, since you wrote it? Oh yeah, she's supportive.
Do you feel like she's your co-author?
Well, certainly she is. Whenever I have to bring a voice into play against what I want to do. For instance, Inconvenient Indian, I started off by saying, you know, okay, I'll start off with Christopher Columbus, 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, that little jingle we used to learn in school. And I was just going to jump off of there, and Helen said, for God's sakes, don't start with Christopher Columbus. And I thought, Jesus, you know, she's telling me how to write now. But then I thought to myself, that's a good way to open it. So I said, you know, Helen has told me not to start with Christopher Columbus. So in 1492, and away we go. And in that particular book, she became that counter voice.
Yeah, she's through that whole book.
Through
the
entire book, yeah, because she was able to say things about my writing that I would allow no one else to say. There's a great line in Cyril de Bergerac where Cyril says, I say those things about myself lightly enough about myself but I allow no other man to say them. And so, Helen is my Cyrano, I suppose, or that character that can say the things that I know are true, but I don't want to say about myself or about my writing. Mm-hmm. So I allow her.
I'm not sure she likes that word.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, you would.
Now, speaking of our co-authors and the people that help us along, or the energies that help us along, Coyote is everywhere in your work. Coyote, trickster, dog, this idea of this outer energy makes appearances in many, if not all, of your books. Why this interconnectedness? Why what is your affinity with Coyote?
Coyote, most people, when they think of Coyote as a trickster figure, they think of a figure that does tricks, that tricks people. And actually, trickster figures aren't that at all. Trickster figures are creatures of appetites. They have these enormous appetites, and the appetites get them into all sorts of trouble. Appetites for power, appetites for money, appetites for sex, appetites for anything you could think of. They always overdo it. So in the Coyote stories, that's what Coyote does. He's always in trouble because of those appetites.
Mm-hmm.
They always get him into trouble, and then he has to try to extricate himself. And there really are cautionary stories so that people that watch what Coyote does can say, you know, well, we shouldn't do that. You know, they really are object lessons. And I'm afraid there's a bit of Coyote in me in that sense of appetites.
Yeah.
And yeah. How would you know?
What?
And I have to figure out some way to control them.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, there's somebody here who knows about that because I took him shopping at Harry Rosen's in Toronto because I didn't think his clothes were the clothes that an administrator should wear. And he said, "You shop here?" I said, "Oh, yeah, I shop here all the time. They're great clothes." So I'm not immune to that.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was writing The Back of the Turtle, I had a character who liked the finer things in life. And so I felt it was incumbent upon me to do the research on that. And I have to tell you, I love stories. I've got to tell you one story. I was downtown Toronto at one of the fine watch stores in town, and I went in and I looked at this a Jaeger Reverso. It's a watch where you can flip the bezel over so you get a black face and a white face. I thought that was really cool. You know, if you're going to be sporty, you turn the black face over. If you're going to be, you know, out for an evening in your tux, you turn the white face over. And Helen was outside. She'd gone down the street to look at. She goes shopping in the consignment stores, the Value Villages of the world. And she came down to the watch store and found me, and she said, "Well, did you find anything?" And I said, "Yeah, I found this Jaeger Reverso." And I said, "Take a look." And she looked at the watch, and I said, "Really like that watch." And she says, "Well," she says, "it's expensive as hell." She said, "But you've had a good year, and you've been writing pretty hard, so if you really want that watch, go ahead and get it." And the salesperson's eyes just got wide as saucers. And I showed her the price tag on it, and she says, "Yeah, it's expensive, but you know, if you want it, go ahead and get it." I had to drag her out of the store, and I said, "How much do you think that watch cost?" And she says, "Well," she says, "$4,400 bucks is a lot to pay for a watch." I said, "44 has 44,000. And to her credit, she said, "What are you thinking?" But I did all the research on that, so you know, I knew the brands, I knew the prices, I knew what people with more money than good sense would buy. I talked to salespeople about, you know, buying habits. It was great. I was awash in appetites. You know, fine dining. You know what? I even did some research while I was here in Montreal.
Ah, of course, of course.
Went to a restaurant, did some research the other night.
Uh-huh.
We discovered, by the way, that if you go to a gourmand restaurant, the chef there feels obligated to put at least one disgusting ingredient in every dish. I couldn't believe some of the stuff that was served up. Peanut brittle on top of a cake? What kind of cake was it? Tamarind cake. Peanut brittle. I don't put peanut brittle anywhere. Anyway, that's research. That's important.
Good research. It's good. It is.
I take it off my taxes.
Let me just say, giant tiger.
Yeah.
No watch.
Now. This, by the way, is not the Jaeger. This is a citizen. Dollar.
That's right.
$1.50.
So I'm going to ask you to read a little bit, if you would.
Sure.
And then I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions about your book.
Okay.
Excellent. Thomas King.
Yeah.
Reading from the back of the journal.
I've got this on, don't I? I can sit down here, can't I? Well, you're not supposed to sit when you read, so I won't. The Back of the Turtle is a book that is in part about an ecological disaster that takes place, a man-made disaster. Defoliant is sprayed into an area, the water runs down a creek, and it destroys this bay, Samaritan Bay, destroys the ocean, destroys everything there. It wipes out a reserve, kills a number of the people. The rest of the people are moved away from the reserve. The town of Samaritan Bay itself is destroyed. Now it's a ghost town. The only people who are there are a character named Gabriel, who's in part responsible for the disaster and who has come back to his home reserve to see the damage that's been done. There's a woman, an artist named Mara, who is from the reserve. And there is a character named Nicholas Crisp, who runs the hot springs and who has stayed even after all of this has happened. So it's a ghost town for the most part. And this is just a little piece, just to give you an idea of the characters, and maybe some of the sound, with Mara and with Nicholas Crisp. Amara's a painter, by the way, and she's begun to paint portraits of the people who were on the reserve, her grandmother, her mother, the rest of the people there. Mara was in sight of the house before her anger began to subside. There was no reason for it. This Gabriel hadn't done anything. He'd simply chased down his pants. The dog in the piece has run off with Gabriel's pants, and he's had to chase the dog up onto the reserve to retrieve the pants. That's never happened to me. He hadn't even crossed the reserve, not like the tourists and the transients who had tramped through the reserve, invaded homes, scavenged for souvenirs, and marked the buildings. Not at first, of course, not when the people were dying. No one came then. Mara tried to remember how long it had taken before curiosity had overcome fear. She had chased more than one gawker off the reserve. At the height of the invasion, she had hidden herself in her grandmother's house and waited for the trespassers to focus their cameras. And then she would shake her hair into seaweed and snakes, fling open the front door, and leap onto the porch, screaming and shrieking. She was not particularly proud of those moments, and she had only done it 3 or 4 times. Okay, maybe more. Mara saw him as she came out of the trees, Nicholas Crisp, sitting in the wicker chair on the veranda. The man appeared to be snoozing in the afternoon sun. On his lap was a small hand drum. Hello, she called out so as not to startle him. Nicholas's eyes slid open and a smile flooded his face. Ah, Mistress Morris, a fine figure you carry around, and with fashion. Mr. Crisp, but aren't you the silver-tongued devil? Nicholas clapped his hands together and rubbed his thighs. I hope you'll forgive the audacity of my having commandeered this fine chair. The chair is there for that very reason. Mara mounted the steps and sat down on the matching sofa. Have you taken up the drum? This? Crisp held the drum out. No, no, I've no such thing, though I fancy I might have a voice for such scales. No, I'd be here when I arrived, sitting on this chair as I am now. Mara took the drum and turned it over. It was well made with time and skill. It was here? Aboriginal, I would guess, said Crisp. Yes, said Mara, so it would appear. Then I take it it's not one of yours. I've not seen it before. And you hadn't anticipated its arrival. Nicholas stroked his beard. Perhaps it's from a secret admirer, for who else would leave such a fine piece of craftsmanship behind with no explanation but the gift itself? Mara struck the drum with a fingertip. The skin was tight and full of sound. Of course, the suggestion of an admirer is mere speculation on my part, and to be prudent, you might want to wait to see what floats up in the wake before you put the wind in your sails. Would you like some coffee, Mr. Crisp? Ah, it's such generosity is what sparkles a day, said Crisp. I put a pot on every morning for courtesy's sake and in hopes of luring passing souls into critique and conversation. But I didn't stop by for a cup, blessed though it would be. I'm here on an errand. An errand? Two, to be precise. Nicholas leaned forward in the chair. The first is to invite you to a festivity. A festivity? Aye, at the hot springs, tomorrow at the full moon. Aha, said Mara, it's your birthday. Ah, it's a nimble memory you have. Crisp ran a fingernail along the wicker. I celebrate it then, I do, for it's a fine excuse for delight and revelry. And just how old are you, Mr. Crisp? Old. Crisp laughed and rubbed the side of his nose. Old and worn to an edge, if the truth is what you wish. So what can I bring? Hope and charity? Nicholas eased himself to his feet. The rest will be provided. You're welcome to stay and sit. Ah, pools to be tended, said Crisp. The boatman paid, guests to be greeted, should any appear. What was the second thing? The second thing? You said you had two errands. Oh, of course, of course. Crisp scratched at his head as though he was hoping to start a fire. I'd almost forgotten the smoke. I was to mention the smoke. Smoke? On my way here, said Crisp, floating above the reserve as though someone were raising up a meal. I was just there, said Mara. I didn't see any smoke. Well, then it was the fog and the mist playing mischievous tricks on these old eyes. Crisp stepped off the porch and filled his lungs with the afternoon air. And wishful thinking, for I was hoping that perhaps your relations had come home. Mara wrapped her arms around herself. No one's coming home. Everyone comes home, said Crisp. Trust an old traveler on that. In the end, we all comes home.
Now, The Back of the Turtle, of course, deals with environmental disaster, but as well as that, it deals with personal disaster. Yep. And discovery, rediscovery. It switches back and forth between past and present. It has good and evil, mysticalism, magic, and all these things in between.
And dogs.
I'm going to get to that dog. All the while, of course, using sharp and pointed humor. Short, a perfect Thomas King novel. But one that you put down for a while because you got a little stuck. In fact, you read you wrote The Inconvenient Indian in the middle of this. When did you pick up the story again, and where did you find it?
Stuck isn't the word for what I was. The true story is I wrote the first chapter. And the first chapter is a chapter in which Gabriel comes back to Samaritan Bay and tries to commit suicide by going off on a stack of rocks called the Apostles. And I had that in place. And it was a good first chapter. And I had no idea what to do with it after that. I had a set of characters that appear in that first chapter besides Gabriel. I had no idea where to go with it. And I worked on it. I don't know how many times I rewrote that first chapter over and over and over again. I tried to keep going and going and going. I couldn't go. And so, you know, a couple of years became 8. 8 years became 10. 10 years became 13. And then, As happens with writing, sometimes if you're really lucky, something clicks. And I realized what I could do with those characters that I had put into that first chapter without any idea what I was going to do with them. And once that happened, then things fell into place. But as you say, in the meantime, I had to do some writing, and so I got a commission for the Inconvenient Indian and wrote that in between working on the back of the turtle, which is why one of the reasons it took so long to get that book out. And I'm having the same trouble with a new novel I'm working on, by the way. I've run into a wall, smack dab into a wall. I don't know where to go with it. This is what comes from not having a plot. I'm terrible at plots. I don't even think about where the novel is going to go. I simply started with a character or with an incident or, you know, just something that catches my ear. It's almost like starting off with the piece of a poem and then trying to stretch it out into a novel, something larger. Mm. And sometimes it works and sometimes it does not.
So. Now I'm going to assume that everybody's read the book. So you can tell us what is it you're trying to say with this book? Was it a reflection of what you see, or was it a warning, or what do you see this book being?
Generally what I do with my books when I'm serious, the serious part of the book is I simply am trying to explain the world to myself. Mm. You know, I look at the world and I say, this is a screwy place. I mean, we've got all sorts of people with very good brains and it is a mess. And how is that possible? How is it possible? And so I start to try to figure it out for myself and sort of write the answer to that. I never get the answer completely right, but in the process I get a chance to, you know, say something about mm-hmm. the world that I mm-hmm. see. So that's pretty much it. There are some things in my novel that are just pure fun. You had mentioned the dog.
The dog, the return of the dog.
Yeah, there was. I had created this dog in Truth and Bright Water, which is a favorite book of mine, a much shorter book than this one is, in case you wanted to read a shorter book than this one. And there's a dog in there named Soldier. And at the end of the novel, Soldier goes off a bridge after another character, and the one character winds up... I shouldn't tell you that, should I? Anyway, my cousin, one of my cousins, who's a good reader and loves me dearly, read the book and thought that I had killed the dog off. And she was really pissed off about that. She said she really liked the book. She said, but how in the world could you kill that dog? And she was angry. I mean, she was angry. And so I said, look, Joanne, tell you what, next book I write, bring the dog back. He's not dead. He just floated down the river out to the sea, and he's going to be there. And so I brought the dog back in this one, and I sent her a copy of the book, and I said, see, the dog is alive. I didn't kill him off at the end of it. And she says, doesn't matter. She said, all these years I've thought that you killed that dog.
So she didn't forgive you.
No.
Oh. Cousins, I
no,
tell you.
No, they're just, you know, come on, you know, family. I got people who don't know me who forgive me.
Now, another animal that survives is the turtle.
Yep.
The turtle that was in the aquarium. And we've been on this turtle before, of course. The turtle makes appearances in many of your stories
yep.
as well. So here we are again on the turtle, on the back of the turtle.
I just can't think of anything else to do.
Is this
do a
turtle,
fox
is it us?
Time.
Is it the earth? Is it all of humanity?
It is. I mean, this particular turtle in this, I suppose, is that kind of dogged determination that we have at our best, where we just keep trying to do the right thing. And in this case, the turtle is trying to get from the East Coast to the West Coast, back to the ocean. Mm-hmm. It just depends on what I want to use it for. You know, and the turtle's a favorite image mm-hmm. of mine.
It's turtles all the way down.
Turtles all the way down. I mean, the turtle is a major figure in Iroquoian creation stories. So mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys have got turtles.
We do.
There you go. So they're important. I've always thought, I mean, I like turtles because they're loners for the most part, like me. They're not particularly pretty. Not like me. And there's a certain determination to them. You know, if you've ever seen turtles walk, you know, those big land tortoises, or even the ones in the ocean that swim, they just keep doing it. You know, and they're long-lived, and I suspect they have long memories too. So they're a favorite of mine. There are no turtles in the new novel.
No. Maybe that's your problem.
And there's no dogs.
Maybe that's your problem.
Maybe that's the problem, yeah. There's a crow. There is a crow.
Oh, crow. I love crow.
I know. I like crows, too.
Big fan of crow.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm getting the old wrap-up, so...
All right.
Thomas King, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you again. We're gonna take just a few questions from the audience. I think there's a mic up here. There is a question here. Is there? Can we get one of our volunteers to pass around the mic? Do we have anybody here? Yes. Great. Oh, Carol, can you grab the mic? Thank you. Carol's there. Yeah. Thank you, Carol.
Thank you, Mr. King.
Yes.
Despite the notable success of people like yourself, certainly the situation between indigenous people and the rest of us is far from ideal. What do you think it's going to take to change that reality?
Oh. Yeah, thanks. I'm going to let Rosanna... I don't know. We have worked out a narrative for so many years, so many hundreds of years, and it's a story that we still believe in Canada, in North America, about the relationship between Native people and non-Native people. I don't know what it's going to take to change that narrative. Certainly, I try to change it in small ways in my writing. There are many other Native writers who try to change that too. I don't know how you go about doing that, but I would say this. The problem really is not with Native people. It really is with non-Native people. And here's the problem. Here's the problem. You guys don't treat yourselves very well. And so we really can't expect that you're going to treat us very well. When I look at the way in which white society moves around profit motives, for example, bottom line kinds of consideration, when I look at when we start talking about social programs, everybody says, well, we don't want to do that. You know, it's just giving a bunch of stuff to people who don't deserve it particularly. But my idea of a society is that the society takes care of its members, you know, right on down the line, that's what it should be doing. When I was doing the back of the turtle and I began looking at what the wealthy do and how they manage their money and how they keep their money, it really looks like a bunch of stingy folks for the most part. It doesn't speak well for non-Native society. And so I think if non-Native society can work on itself and get it to the point where it's more generous, not charitable. Charitable is a very different thing than generosity. I think non-Native society has certainly a charitable aspect to it, but it's no longer generous. I look at Native society, and even though we don't have a whole hell of a lot, there is an innate generosity there that I think would be, you know, a decent model for other groups. But that's just me. I mean, it probably sound like I'm building this dichotomy between Natives and non-Natives. I'm not trying to do that. I'm trying to say that, you know, we live within a societal unit, and it would be nice if we would act like that, rather than, you know, it's just an opportunity to make a bunch of money. I got nothing against money.
If I may, let me just add that I think you would be a fine example to emulate.
Thank you.
Great. We're running a bit over, so we probably have time for two more brief questions.
Thank you. Brief answers, right?
I love your work, and Green Grass Running Water was wonderful. Oh. I like all your work. Yes, but I'm wondering about the Dead Dog Cafe. This wasn't mentioned.
I knew that.
Is there any chance of your writing any more Dead Dog Cafe? Hooray!
Madam.
Not while my show is on.
Madam, thank you very much. You've made it 100%. I don't think I've ever gone any place to do any kind of talk where someone has not asked me about Dead Dog Cafe.
So you better do something about it.
Yeah. The dog is dead.
Oh.
And what killed it, I'll tell you what killed it. I decided to run for federal office, and when I did, CBC closed me down immediately.
Hmm.
Or I closed myself down. I could not be a candidate and do that radio show. I mean, it was not a music show, was it? And the people I was running against were going to say, hey, you know, you can't let this Yahoo use the airways to spew his filth while he's running for office. And so I had to close the show down. And when I came back after my unsuccessful bid, I beat the Communist Party. At that point, then CBC said, no, you're politically motivated. But I am working on a show called Quack that I don't know if it's ever going to see the light of day, but it's a good idea, and I'll try to make sure that your show is off the air by the time.
When are you leaving?
Okay, I think we have time for one more question.
All right. Wajah, and thanks for your stories. I just wanted to say you should have been on my PhD committee then. Maybe you would have won. Anyways, I haven't asked you a while ago, but anyways, I just want to say that since the guy was asking about the problems with the Native people and the relationships, maybe it's time to revive Joe the Painter too. I remember in 1993 when I first heard it on CBC Radio, it was like, oh my God, you know. Thanks for the storytelling, and what do we do with them? Because we're in the other generation of storytellers here.
Yeah, I'm hoping, actually, I mean, I'm going to turn 73 this year, and I feel, you know, like I'm as old as my mother. And when I look around, what I really want to see is that next generation of storytellers coming along. Mm. And I see it in part. I see it in Eden Robinson, in Tracy Lindbergh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I see it in Joseph Boyden. I see it in Richard Wagamese. But what I don't see right now, because they're hard to see, are those storytellers who are coming up in that generation past that. And I just assume that they're there and they're going to be coming along, and that what our job is, the older storytellers, is just to be able to stand there and say it's possible for you to have your words heard. It's possible for you to maybe make your living as a storyteller. That really is my job, just to sort of be a signpost. I hope that people see that and come along. So please, join the crowd.
Thank you.
Sure. You jumped right in there, didn't you?
Uh-huh.
Write a scary story? Well, yeah, some of my stories I consider to be very scary. I don't write scary stories in the standard way of them being scary, I suppose. Have I written a scary story? Well, I wrote a story about old people who were put on into this game preserve, and once a year you get to hunt them. Is that? It's called, actually, the story is called The Closer You Get to Canada, the More Things Will Eat Your Horses. That's kind of scary.
It's hilarious. What do you mean?
That's a great end. That's a great note to end the evening on.
Death and destruction.
Let's thank the Thomas King and Rosanna Deerchild. Very quickly, just two. Thank you. Two very quick points. First of all, I just want to say that Thomas King will be signing books, and there are books outside. He will be signing your books, so please buy books and please get them signed. The petition for Pen Canada is out outside, and you can sign that if you like. I just want to say one brief thing, which is Part of our deal with the McConnell Foundation is that our funding for this prize expires next year. So we are looking for a sponsor. We want to continue this prize. We want to be able to continue it into the future. So please contact us if you're interested in being involved in helping us support the prize. Thank you very much for being here, everyone. Have a very good night.